Hi everyone, I'm Pallavi. I'm an IT consultant and also a lifestyle influencer. And most important role I play is I am a mom blogger as well. So today I have the privilege to have Dr. Pratima Raj with us. She is the gynec oncologist at Manipal Hospital, Old Airport Road, Bangalore. And today, doctor, I want to discuss with you the most trending topic that's going on, I think, in every layman and woman's heart, that is about cervical cancer. I think this is the very necessary topic that has to be discussed. So I'd like to take the opportunity, doctor, to discuss about it with you.
Sure, Pallavi. You can go ahead with the, any questions you have.
So who are the people who are more prone to this cervical cancer? Is it because of a lifestyle choice, a fooding habit, or what are the reasons why people might get infected by this?
Okay, so first of all, we know that according to the Globocan fact sheet, just now you said that there are more than 3 lakh cases being diagnosed throughout the worldwide, and then more than 50% succumb to death. So why this mortality rate is high? It's because there's lack of awareness among women. So when they come to us or when they present to us in the OPD, they usually come in an advanced stage. So cervical cancer, we all know it's a cancer of the uterine cervix, that is the mouth of the uterus. And also we know that cervical cancer, that is 90% of the cervical cancer are caused by HPV, that is human papillomavirus infections, right? So this is again a sexually transmitted infection. But it is not that everyone who comes with this, who gets infected this virus will have cancer, will develop cancer. Is at least 70 to 80% of them will clear this virus from their body due to their own immune system. But there are some certain instances where the virus persists in the body. When the virus persists in the body, then there are changes in the cervical cells, abnormalities, and then that can lead to a cervical cancer later on. So approximately it takes around 10 to 15 years or maybe 20 years for a cancer to develop from the infection stage. So that's what I was telling, that not everybody who gets infected this virus will develop cancer, but due to certain risk factors. So talking about the risk factors, coming to the lifestyle thing, what we say is, so since we know it's a sexually transmitted infection, so if somebody is having multiple sexual partners, they can acquire multiple subtypes of HPV infections as well. So they are at risk of developing cancer later on. Early child marriage, and then multiple pregnancies. Okay, and also if somebody is having a habit of smoking and alcohol addictions and with obesity. So we know obesity is also one of the leading factors for most of the cancers, and even cervical cancers, obesity can make this virus persist, and then they can have cancer later on. And also if somebody is having excessive exposure to oral contraceptive pills, and also with a low immune system body. So because if a good immune system, the infection usually gets cleared off from the body. But sometimes due to our own body immune system is poor, or if somebody with who are on immunosuppressants, or with a chronic kidney failure, or who was on dialysis, who are on immunosuppressant drugs, or who are having other immunosuppressive diseases like HIV and other chronic illness, or in such patients this virus tends to retain for a long time. And also if a patient or if a woman with other sexually transmitted infections, not only HPV, if they are having some HTLV or HIV, syphilis. So with other sexually transmitted infections also, they can tend to have this persistence of these infections.
So as I understand, doctor, you mentioned about early marriage could be one of the reasons. So do you think there is an age group which is more prone to this, or how is it?
Yeah, so they, what we see is there is a bimodal age group where we see the cervical cancer disease. That is, first is around 30 to 45 years, one of the age group we see, and the other group is 60 to 70 years. This is because what happens is, if we say early child marriage, because if the girl is very she's young and she's a child and she gets married, and that again could be due to a lot of trauma to her, and also her immunity would not have been developed, and also it's lot of exposure to the sexual activity, and even these kind of early child marriages, and these will happen in most of the rural areas where there won't be any hygiene, malnutrition. So there are many other associated factors also. So due to this, like, you know, they can have a persistence of this infection for a long time. You think somebody is getting sexually active at the age of 12 years and then exposure of that infection at the age of 12 years. So she has a bit long time of being infected with virus. So maybe by the age of 30 years or 35 years, if that virus is persistent, she will develop cancer at a very young age.
And what are the symptoms that, like, of course, symptoms will appear, I think, quite later to the stage, right? It will not be very early, but what are the most common symptoms?
So symptoms, what we say is most of the cancer, not only cervical cancer, most of the cancer early, I mean, they are usually asymptomatic most of the time, okay? And cervical cancer also, it's asymptomatic in early phases. But as the phase, I mean the stage or the phase changes, then the symptom starts appearing. But the most common symptoms which usually people or generally tend to ignore is one of the most important thing is post-coital bleeding. Post-coital bleeding is something, a bleeding that happens after a sexual intercourse. Okay, so that one, it's, I mean, it's a very highlighted symptom. And somebody is having abnormal vaginal discharge, or it could be a foul smelling discharge associated with spotting or bleeding, or some discharge and it's chronically getting heavier, but the discharge is not getting away with the treatment or conservative management, whatever they are taking, even after the medications, it's not getting solved. Okay, and then abnormal bleeding, abnormal uterine bleeding, that is bleeding between intermenstrual cycles, or sometimes a prolonged bleeding, it could happen. And also, like, you know, postmenopausal bleeding, most of the women, especially who have like, you know, attained menopause, and sometimes they say that they started seeing some pinkish discharge,
and
or
a common factor, and people yes. think that maybe, you know, it's just, it's very normal. That's what I hear,
they say it's because of heat,
yeah,
or, you know, they just tend to ignore.
I have heard that. Surprisingly, I've heard that so many times,
yes,
from older women. They feel like maybe they just attain menopause, so it's very normal to bleed,
yeah,
again,
yeah. Yeah, okay, that is a very
concern.
It's a very significant. If any woman has a slight amount of spotting or a postmenopausal bleeding, they should not ignore.
Okay.
It could be any signs of a cancer from a genital tract.
Okay.
There are other infections as well, but still this has to be given very importance and significance, and cancer has to be ruled out. Okay, these are in the early stages. But as this stage advances, like, you know, they can start having other manifestations, like, you know, they can have abdominal distension, pain in the lower abdomen, or they could have a swelling in the limbs, legs, and they can start having backache, back pain, or if the cancer metastasizes to the lungs, then they can have breathlessness. If the cancer metastasizes to the brain, they can have other, like, you know, issues like strokes and other things. So this is how, like, you know, cancer, it depends upon the stage. And also in very advanced stages, they can again have a rectovaginal fistula or a urethrovaginal fistula. It means that they can pass motions from the vagina itself, or they can start passing urine because the tract gets connected, the motion tract and the bladder tract with the vagina. So these all are the later signs of the disease.
And what are the different treatments already you have mentioned? Doctor has already mentioned the treatments. If you just have to summarize them, like, what would you?
So that's what, if again, the treatment all depends upon the stage and the extent of the disease and the type of a tumor. So if it is feasible for surgery, that is early stage disease, and it's always, like, you know, surgery is the best. If it's early, then we'll definitely do a good surgeries. We have all the technologies of surgeries, fertility preserving surgeries. So if a person wants to preserve her fertility, we can go for a fertility preserving surgeries. If she has completed fertility, then again we can go for a completion surgery. Okay, radical surgeries we have. And if she has come in an advanced stage as well, we still have a good, like, you know, chemotherapy drugs, immunotherapies, targeted therapies. Based on these, like, you know, even her disease can be controlled, and sometimes it can be cured also. And we have a good radiation technology also. That is, with cancer cervix advanced stage, we give radiation as well. That is external radiation, internal radiation. And these days, these radiation therapies are also, like, targeted. Earlier, whenever it was a radiation therapy, it used to be extensive, and they would have a lot of side effects, and they would not be tolerable. So these days, we have a targeted radiation, which will only target the site which we have to focus. So based on these advancements, we have good treatment for us, like, you know, the disease can be controlled and still can be cured as well.
I think we all almost got a rough idea, and I also am aware of government has passed a bill for women getting free HPV vaccines. Can you just say about that?
Yes, yeah, so like, you know, recently our Honorable Minister, Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharam, has announced that like, you know, HPV vaccination should be made free for all the girls of age 9 to 12 years. So this is has been announced. So yes, it is a good initiative if government is taking on this.
So these vaccines, doctor, is just for the girls aged 9 to 15 or can be given to
vaccine? Yes, yes. Vaccination, it is not only for girls, it also can be extended to boys, because HPV infection, it not only causes cancer in women. So HPV in women, it causes cervical cancer, vaginal cancer, vulval cancer, anogenital warts. But same in men, it causes penile cancer, anogenital cancers.
So
cancer.
It can be transmitted to men?
Yes, yes. It is a sexual transmitted infection. It can be transmitted either ways, right? So penile cancers, and also in both of them, they can have a oropharyngeal cancers, so head and neck cancers. So it is not only we are preventing cervical cancer, we are preventing all HPV related cancers.
I think thank you so much, doctor, for giving us so much of information about this cervical cancer, which is round the topic, but I think people were not understanding. Even I had so many doubts which you cleared, like this can be transferred to men and they will have something respectively more or similarly dangerous, and it can be prevented by, you know, giving vaccination to kids at the age of 9 to 15 before their sexual debut, that what you're mentioning. So I think overall the takeaway will be that everybody should take the vaccine, the awareness should be high, government is introducing vaccines, everybody should opt for it, and people should have, women should have good lifestyle choices, like taking care of their weight, of course, like you said, obesity is one of the leading reasons, and smoking and drinking, everything should be, you know, reduced. And I think overall we have to take care of our health, and screening is, I think, number one necessary thing, because we have to be aware of it, and I think prevention is always, you know, better. Thank you so much, doctor, for enlightening us with all the information that I think most of the women were having, and that was very, very helpful.
Thank you for coming, and thank you for, like, you know, you are such a big influencer, so it's my pleasure to, like, you know, speak to you, and maybe through you all the followers will get to know what it is and how.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
This is such a big value add, I will tell you, doctor. I'm so privileged to have a conversation with you, because this is something which is such a value add for the society, because many people are not aware of it. And I think right now Google is the biggest doctor that everybody follows. For every question, we go to Google and YouTube, but getting it to hear from the doctor herself is a big thing. So it's really helpful for all of us.
Maybe all the followers will definitely benefit from you.
Absolutely, absolutely they will. It was a pleasure talking to you, doctor, and thank you so much.
Same.